Hi there, my name is Thomas. I'm representing investmentexcel.com. Today, in this session where we will demonstrate how to estimate the parameters of the Vasicek process and the model with help of a Euler transformation of the continuous stochastic setting in the Vasicek model. Please refer to other sessions we have made on the Vasicek model if you like to take a deeper look into the more theoretical framework. This session will focus primarily on the estimation side. This video and the Excel workbook and all the underlying VBA coding are available for download on investmentexcel.com and spotify.com. But before we estimate, let's just look at the theoretical framework briefly. The Vasicek process, or what is really called an Ornstein-Uhlenbeck process, is a stochastic process describing the future evolution of one short rate. That's why it's called a one-factor model. And this evolution is governed by a trend, or a mean reverting drift, and a volatility, a constant volatility. The mean reversion drift, which is represented by this factor here, captures cyclicality in the economy. So the short rate in a future point of time will never explode one way or another. So it will ultimately settle to the mean reverting level at B. But during the process, there is a pulling force, so that every time the rate is below this mean reverting level, it has a tendency to go the other way, or up. And on the other hand, if the rate is higher than the mean reverting level, it will go down. So there is a, maybe call it a pulling force in the model. So it's not, it looks like a random walk, but it's not a random walk, because this process is stationary given the mean reverting drift. But it has the same features in terms of the distribution, like the random walk. It's a normal distribution governed by this Wiener process here in the W. This process can easily be solved into a SDE solution for the interest rate. So at any point of time t, the rate is given by this semi-ugly expression. But it's not more ugly than it's very, very easy to calculate the mean and the variance for the normal distribution. And as we see here, the expected rate, the mean at time t in the future, is only conditional on the current and observed rate. This is what we call a Markov property. Also here you'll see that if t goes to infinity, so that's in the very, very long run in the process, if we simulate 2,000 years ahead, all the exponential, the two exponential expressions will go out and it will leave us with B. So the long run mean of this process is the mean reversing level. The variance is constant in its parameters, so no conditionality on the rate today either. So this is the continuous setting as originally formulated by Vasicek. We need to use OLS to estimate the parameters here. So we need a discrete version. And this is a popular discrete version called a Euler discretion. Still we have the mean reverting factor here. And here we have the stochastic factor. If we transform this model by simply calculating out here, we get the top equation. So now we have a true model describing the change in the rate by a drift here and a conditional drift on R, and we have the error described by a normal distribution. We can calculate further and substitute out the A, B with W and Z so that we get a simple and nice true model for the change in the interest rate. So we have a constant W here, which is A, B, and we have a constant here Z representing minus A, and then we have the residual, and the residual is in our case a monthly residual, which can be seen here. So here we have the framework for the OLS. So on the left hand we have the endogenous variable, and on the right side hand we have the exogenous variable being just the rate. So now we are ready to estimate. Let's just look at historical time series. I have 36 observations. I have 36 observations. So for the 3 months LIBOR, but I also need the change in LIBOR, which is the left hand side of the OLS equation. So simply taking this minus this. So this column is the left hand side of the equation over here, and this one is the right hand side. So now I will just calculate W and Z, and I use Excel's intercept function to calculate the W. So intercept Y being this column and X, if you like, being this column. So we get a constant of 0.06, and the slope, I use the slope function, same input, same range, and now what I need is just to transform them according to these two equations down here, and we get a conversion factor of 1.24 and a mean reversion level of 4.88. So all these things can be done with the Excel function. Now what we need, and something that often causes problems for people, is how to calculate the volatility. The volatility is the square root of the estimated residuals adjusted for the degrees of freedom. And there is one formula in Excel called sum x xmy2, which takes the difference between the model change, which we have here, and the actual change, and sums them on a squared basis. But remember, when we do that, it's on a monthly basis. I would like to have a annualized volatility, so I have to multiply by square root 12. I have created these LIBOR rates generically, so they are not actual LIBOR rates observed in the market, but I just let Excel calibrate some numbers, or build some numbers. But it wasn't totally arbitrarily. I made some inputs. I actually created a series on the Vasicek formula. So with a speed of convergence 1.5, mean reversing level of 5, sigma 0.2, and then time step 1 over 12. So our final numbers should be approximately those that the model actually was built on. And we see here the convergence 1.25 is not exactly the same, but this is just a sample that we have created from the true population built in these models. I can just use F9 to sample one more time. And this time we see the convergence is 1.353. So it's close. So this is the way to estimate the parameters in the Vasicek process. And up here in the graphs, I have first the actual predicted change or levels of the LIBOR starting in 4%, as we see here. And here we have compared to each other. So not a perfect fit, but this is the way to estimate it. Now, these parameters that we have estimated can be used in the pricing formula of zero coupon bonds on all maturities at a given time and at other times. And this is what I have done here. So here's a link to the parameters, and then using this ugly formula we can calculate at any time with a simulated path, we can calculate the term structure. So here, for instance, 1 year ahead, 2 year ahead, I have calculated the orange and blue term structure, and let's see how it works if I make new changes in the rate. We see the red and blue term structure moving according to the functionality form of the Vasicek model. The only thing that I have not estimated is the market risk premium, another parameter that is needed, not in order to build the Vasicek process, but in order to build the full Vasicek model, the pricing of the zero coupon bonds. This is something that was needed in order for Vasicek to build a total partial differential equation, was to include a market risk premium. So even though it's the way that he built the bond pricing, the general bond pricing formula represented by the PD was the same as in the Black and Scholes formula, he had to include a risk premium because he could not use the same replication arguments because of the underlying rate not being a tradable rate. So he could not use the same exactly the same technique as in the Black and Scholes framework, where the drift or all risk compensation cancels out. So we have to include this premium, but it can be estimated as well, but we haven't done it in this framework. But we can do it in another framework with the maximum likelihood, which we will do in another session. Thank you for listening. Bye bye.